From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Dermatology Author Interviews. Conversations with authors exploring the latest clinical research, reviews, and opinions featured in JAMA Dermatology.
Hello and welcome to our listeners around the world. You're listening to JAMA Dermatology Author Interviews. Thanks for joining us. I'm Dr. Ade Adamson, the web editor for JAMA Dermatology, and also the host of this podcast episode. Basal cell carcinomas, also known as BCCs, are among the most common skin cancers diagnosed by dermatologists. Surgical excision is the most common treatment. However, there remains interest in non-invasive treatment modalities. For superficial BCCs, it has been demonstrated that Imiquimod 5% cream has high long-term efficacy. But for nodular BCCs, long-term evidence is sparse. In a new study in JAMA Dermatology, authors conduct a randomized clinical trial aimed at evaluating whether superficial curettage followed by Imiquimod 5% cream is non-inferior to that of surgical excision in nodular basal cell carcinomas at 5 years post-treatment. Dr. Babette Verkouteren is an academic researcher from Maastricht University Medical Center located in the Netherlands. She is the first and corresponding author of this new study and here to discuss this work. Welcome to the podcast, Dr. Verkouteren.
Thank you. It's great to be here. Thanks for the invite.
And I want to know a little bit more about your work at Maastricht. I understand that you're currently a resident training doing Mohs, but then you got a PhD. For those that don't quite understand the medical education system in the Netherlands, do you mind telling us a little bit about your journey to where you're at right now in terms of medical training?
Yeah, definitely. So usually in the Netherlands, around when you're 18, you go to the university and you go directly into medical school. It takes 6 years' time, and I finished that in 2018. And after that, you usually work as a resident, but not in training. You can do this at several specialties: surgery, internal medicine, dermatology. And it is possible to start with a PhD already before you're a resident. So that's what I did. I started in 2019. And then in 2021, I also started with my residency for dermatology. And then in the last years, I combined both jobs, research and my residency. Last year, I defended my PhD thesis with success.
Congrats.
Thank you very much. And now I'm focusing mainly on finishing my residency. It takes 5 years in the Netherlands, and I'm currently in my fourth year. And during residency, it's an option to also do Mohs surgery training, which is what I'm doing right now as well.
So I take it that this project that you're going to be discussing today, it spawns from your research and your PhD.
Yes, that's correct. My supervisor, Professor Clara Mustard, she initiated trial in 2016 already, and I did the five-year follow-up of this trial.
So what got you interested in doing this work, this specific study? Was it you seeing patients that perhaps may want to opt for less invasive treatment for nodular basal cell carcinomas? Maybe it was a personal experience, or what drove you to want to study this?
I think it was a combination. Of course, we all know the facts. You stated in the introduction as well. The incidence is still rising, can be a healthcare problem in the future as well. And although surgical excision is the most effective treatment, non and minimal invasive options have several benefits, such as better cosmetic outcome, the possibility to perform the treatment at home, and a decrease in the possible workload of the physicians. And I saw a lot of patients that were also had surgical fatigue or wanted to be treated just at home, not come back to the hospital again, because it are mainly older patients that are the basal cell carcinoma population. And our previous study that was done by our department compared 5-fluorosil to Imiquimod 5% cream and photodynamic treatment in superficial basal cell carcinoma. And there we found after 5 years of treatment that Imiquimod cream was the most superior treatment with 80.5% clearance rate after 5 years. And we all see it's generally accepted to see nodular basal cell carcinoma in low-risk areas also as a low-risk tumor. So we wondered if this most effective non-invasive treatment option was also an option in nodular basal cell carcinoma.
And the way you guys set out designing this clinical trial wasn't looking for superiority. It was looking for non-inferiority. Why did you all decide to pursue that method of study?
Yeah, that's a great question, because we already knew that there was a high efficacy rate in surgical excision. So mainly after 5 years, it's between 95 and 100% in literature. And we know the Imiquimod cream would be less, but we would find it acceptable if it wouldn't be too less because of the other benefits, which I stated before, better cosmetic outcome, probably the option to treat at home and by the patients themselves.
So for this study, it was a randomized clinical trial, and your primary outcome was recurrence at 5 years. And then you also had a secondary outcome of cosmesis. So how did it look? Is that correct?
That's correct. We measured it with the POSA skill, which is the patient and observer outcome for cosmetic outcomes, and also with the FOSS score, visual analog scale from 1 to 10. And we found interesting results because the researchers and observers rated the cosmetic outcome better in the Imiquimod group compared to the surgical excision group, whereas in patients, didn't really seem to matter. They were all very glad with the outcome. They all scored excellent, good to excellent results.
And before we jump to the results, kind of want to know your hypothesis. What did you think was going to happen? I guess first, you probably should tell the listeners about the one-year results from this clinical trial, because this is just the five-year outcomes that are part of this particular paper. But how did you think, or how much worse did you think that the Imiquimod group would do compared to the surgical excision group? Did you think they would be roughly comparable?
Yes, we thought it would be, because previous studies that have been performed in superficial basal cell carcinoma didn't really show an enormous decrease in efficacy 5 years after treatment. But you never know it if you don't study it. So that's why, of course, we had to check it.
And can you tell the listener a little bit more about the intervention? Right, because it wasn't just a Imiquimod. How were the basal cells diagnosed? Where was it, like a shave? Was it a punch biopsies? What other intervention did they have? And how was the surgical excision done? What were the margins?
So the surgical excision was performed with a 3 millimeter margin clinically. And it was, of course, checked by the dermatologists in our hospital. We included patients based on the 3 millimeter punch biopsy that was taken from the tumor. And the tumor had to be between 4 and 20 millimeters in diameter. The biopsies were also checked by a dermatopathologist, and tumors were included if they were nodular or nodular and superficial. Aggressive forms were excluded from the study. And a previous study by Williams et al. Also looked into Imiquimod cream for superficial and nodular basal cell carcinoma, but they treated the nodular basal cell carcinomas for 12 weeks with Imiquimod cream for 7 days a week. And we hypothesized that combining the mechanic effect of superficial curettage with the anti-tumor effect of the Imiquimod cream, that would lead to a better outcome and a shorter duration needed of the Imiquimod cream. And the superficial curettage was performed up to the level of the adjacent skin. So a patient came in, we took a biopsy, diagnosis was confirmed, and the patient came back to our hospital for the inclusion visit, where we did perform curettage up to the level of the adjacent skin if it was still a little bit of tumor bulk there. And then a week after, they started with the Imiquimod cream, 6 weeks for 5 days per week.
And then you just followed them for 5 years to see whether there was recurrence.
Yeah, the patients with the Imiquimod cream came back 3 months after treatment to check if there was residual tumor. And after 1 year, we saw all the patients. And after 5 years, we saw them all again.
And what were the results of the 1 year, which is the previous trial? And then what were the results that you found for this trial?
We made a pre-specified non-inferiority margin of 8% based on the efficacy of surgical excision of 98%. So it was acceptable if Imiquimod cream had an efficacy of 90%. And after 1 year, we found non-inferiority margin of -13.7%. So there was 100% efficacy in the surgical excision group and 86.3% efficacy in the Imiquimod cream group. But with the 95 confidence interval, there wasn't a conclusion that superficial curettage plus Imiquimod cream was inferior to surgical excision.
Because it included the margin that you had pre-specified.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, and after 5 years, we wanted to see if that was still the case or that it did become inferior to surgical excision. And we found that it didn't become inferior. So 5 years after treatment, the response in the Imiquimod group was 77.8% compared to 98.2% in the surgical excision group.
So most people that see a result like that, most dermatologists would be like, that's a lot less effective than surgical excision. We're talking 98%, just one patient that was randomized to the standard excision group developed a recurrence, whereas many more developed it in the Imiquimod and superficial curettage group. So that's 78% versus 98%. That's roughly a 20% difference. That's a lot. Yet we conclude in this paper that it can't be concluded that there's a difference. Can you explain how do you square that difference?
That's a very good question. The difference is substantial, but using the statistic rules, the 95% confidence interval still has the non-inferiority margin in it because it was very broad 95% confidence interval. And we have to ask ourselves, we accept it for superficial basal cell carcinoma, an 80% treatment success chance after 5 years. And in the current guidelines, low-risk nodular basal cell carcinoma and low-risk superficial basal cell carcinoma are just seen as the same kind of tumors.
And I also want to make sure that I point out, were there any restrictions to the parts of the body where these basals were? Did you exclude head and neck basal cell carcinomas or in high-risk areas? Are these just basals everywhere on the body?
No, it were basal cell carcinomas between 4 and 20 millimeters in diameter, and we excluded basal cell carcinomas on the H zone of the face. So there were lesions in the head and neck, but not in the H zone of the face. And we also excluded basal cell carcinomas on the hairy scalp.
Now, with these data, were you surprised at how different the two arms were in terms of risk of recurrence?
No, I wasn't surprised at all, actually. I hypothesized we would get similar numbers. We cannot directly compare this study to all the other studies that have been performed. But when you look in the literature, it's always ranging between 75-85% of the tumors, superficial and nodular basal cell carcinomas that respond to Imiquimod treatment. So I wasn't surprised that that was our result as well.
So with this information, what would you counsel patients or dermatologists on how to process it? Should we make a recommendation that patients undergo this non-invasive kind of treatment versus standard excision? Or should this be part of the options that patients get?
I think it should definitely be part of the options that patients get. We should use this information to counsel patients on the relative benefits and trade-offs of the different treatment options for nodular basal cell carcinoma, as well as all the dermatologists.
So what's next in this space? Is there a follow-up study, maybe looking at different histologic types or maybe basal cells that are larger or some other outcome of interest or maybe some other non-invasive treatment? Or maybe a longer treatment with Imiquimod. Maybe it just wasn't treated with Imiquimod long enough to clear it.
Based on the previous study by Williams et al., I don't think a longer application time of Imiquimod is the key to a higher treatment success. We looked into several tumor characteristics, such as tumor depth, but we saw that even tumors that expanded in the subcutaneous fat area responded to Imiquimod as well. A discussion point of our study is that we did a biopsy, 3 millimeter biopsy, which is also a little bit of tumor debulking. And then a week after that, patient had to come back for the curettage to be performed before they could start with the Imiquimod application. So we might be able to see if curettage can be used as a diagnostic strategy. So you can just do the curettage and then start the Imiquimod cream. But we also hypothesize that Imiquimod as an immunomodulating cream might need tumor bulk to get a response, as we see in melanomas and immune therapy as well. In our center, we do a lot of research with optical coherence tomography as well, and we're currently performing a study where we use that as a diagnostic strategy. So OCT diagnosed basal cell carcinoma, low risks, are treated with either surgical excision or Imiquimod cream. And then we have a group of people that didn't really have tumor debulking. So we're very curious to see if that leads to similar results.
Anything else about this study that we may not have covered that you think the listeners should know about?
I think we covered everything that we need to know. I think one important thing that we didn't discuss yet are the side effects. Because I hear a lot of time people say, other physicians, there are a lot of possibility to get flu-like symptoms with the Imiquimod cream. In our study, none of the patients had flu-like symptoms. And also in other studies, the reported amount of patients that had flu-like symptoms was very low. So this shouldn't be a reason to not discuss this treatment with patients. I think a lot of patients are very happy. That's what we saw in our study as well, that they would choose this treatment again in the future. So I think that's very important to take into account as well.
And that includes patients that had a recurrence.
Yes.
Right. Even those patients were okay with the choice that they had made.
Exactly.
Which I find pretty interesting as well.
Yeah, I think I'm not sure this is a guess, but there are a lot of patients that have several basal cell carcinomas. We all know them from our practice. And if you can treat a lot of them and a lot of them go away, just a few of them come back and you have to treat it with surgery, it can be an option for several patients with multiple basal cell carcinomas.
I'm Dr. Ade Adamson, and I've been speaking with Dr. Babette Verkouteren about long-term efficacy of superficial curettage followed by 5% Imiquimod cream compared to surgical excision in nodular basal cell carcinoma. You can find a link to the paper in this episode's description. This episode was produced by Daniel Musisi at the JAMA Network. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com or search for JAMA Network wherever you get your podcasts. Thanks for listening. Catch you on the next episode of the JAMA Dermatology Podcast.
This content is protected by copyright by the American Medical Association with all rights reserved, including those for text and data mining, AI training, and similar technologies.